All right. This meeting of the Stafford County Board of Supervisors is called to order. Will the clerk please call the roll?
Ms. Bumke?
Here.
Mr. Cavalier?
Here.
Mrs. Maurer?
Here.
Mr. Milday?
Here.
Ms. Sellers?
Here.
Mr. Snellings?
Here.
Mr. Thomas?
Here.
Mr. Chairman, you have a quorum.
All right, thank you very much. Good afternoon to everyone here and at home that is joining us. My name is Paul Milday. I represent the Aquia District on the Stafford County Board. Something kind of big happened over the weekend. I'm sure that anyone that reads papers saw it because it got great coverage. But 12 years ago, I got elected, and it was a hot issue, the Crow's Nest. Stafford had virtually no land in conservation, and the Crow's Nest was under threat of development. It was indeed owned by developers. Long story short, this board and the boards since then really put in place purposefully and deliberately different strategies and policies that have resulted in 10,000 acres being in conservation in Stafford County. The biggest pieces of that puzzle or mosaic, if you will, are Crow's Nest, Widewater State Park, and the Rappahannock River easement. So I'm proud to say that we dedicated the Crow's Nest this weekend. The main area, most of the 3,000 acres, was not accessible by the public for the last 10 years since we purchased it. And we had some pretty notable, it was not Stafford County's event. For some people weren't on the list. I was lucky to get invited to that event, as was the board, but it was the state's thing. And we had the governor, who flew in a helicopter to the Brook VRE and made a grand entrance, and he gave great remarks. And of course, the Speaker of the House of Delegates, who has been very, very helpful in the conservation efforts in Virginia, was there. Crow's Nest is about 3,000 acres. It's home to many rare and endangered and listed species of animals and plants. So, and it's a unique partnership. We own the Crow's Nest jointly with the state. That's somewhat of an unusual situation. And that's because we put in our money where our mouth is, if you will, the $9.5 million seed money to get the state, to show the state that we were interested in actually doing something there. And they came up with the rest, and the rest was a lot. Although it was misreported, and I'm pretty sure the price tag in the Freelance Star was overestimated. So it was a few million high, but that wasn't our money. But with that, I wanted to welcome our superintendent of the schools, Bruce Benson, and have you come up here and update us, please.
Thank you, Chairman Milday. Vice Chair Bomke, members of the board, Mr. Foley, thank you. Appreciate the opportunity to share a little bit of our ongoing work in the school system. And I have three primary areas I want to provide just a little brief overview for you all this afternoon. The first has to do with our C5 Learning Walks initiative. This is really strongly connected to work that's going on at the state level, although I'd like to say that we are a little bit ahead of the state in identifying these as being important areas for us to be looking for in our classroom, particularly the five C's: communication, collaboration, critical thinking, creativity, and citizenship. The Commonwealth of Virginia has identified these as part of a portrait of graduate for graduates within the Commonwealth. They have not defined them as well as we would like them to have defined them at this point. So we have gone ahead and kind of done our own definition that we think is pretty close to where we'll end up when the Commonwealth does some additional work. We did add a wellness, which we think is important, an important add to the five C's. But, that we want our young people to be good communicators when they graduate from us in all forms, oral, written, and nonverbal communication. We want them to understand how to work well with others in order to achieve positive outcomes. Think critically, to engage in inquiry in our classrooms, to respond with a certain level of cognitive demand in the response to questions that we're asking, to be creative, to be good citizens, and of course, take care of themselves, and that we foster that in an environment that it attends to physical, emotional, and intellectual needs. And next thing you might ask is, well, how will you know whether those things are happening or not? Because they're not necessarily things that would get measured by an SOL test. And so we have developed a learning walk model. And if you turn the page over to the second part of the attachment, there it says C5W learning walks. And then we have the areas listed out, communication, collaboration, critical thinking, and then there are look-fors that are there that you would expect to see in a classroom. The look-fors are based upon research-based best practices in terms of how those things happen in classrooms and how they contribute to raising the level of student achievement. We've developed an electronic application that we'll be using to record that information as we visit classrooms throughout the division, and we're going to have principals and teachers walking together looking at practices in that are occurring in classrooms for evidence of students being given the opportunity to engage in this kind of work. We'll collect that as baseline data in the fall and then look to improve student opportunity to engage in that kind of work over time. So we're excited about that. These are important skills. They're certainly things that I've heard from business folks in our community that's being important in employees, and we think that they're important in with regard to success pretty much in any direction that our young people want to head. We've also undertaken a reorganization of our what was the Office of Instruction to create an Office of Organizational Development and Professional Learning, and so I've included what the org chart looked like prior to the reorganization, very much a hierarchical organizational chart. We felt like it was important to try and flatten that hierarchy a little bit so that we have folks working together and not so much in silos and competing for the same resources within the organization. It'll help us focus on interdisciplinary connections across the content areas and really develop, we think, a curriculum framework for the school system as a whole that will raise level of student achievement across the board. Our curriculum right now is largely Virginia's SOL, except where we have programs in place like International Baccalaureate. The division really needs an overarching framework to set expectations for what we would expect to see in classrooms everywhere, whether you're participating in one of those programs or not. So we've provided a little bit of what that is. We think that's going to look like come the start of the next school year. And then we've attached one of the job descriptions so you can have an opportunity to take a look at that. I won't read that. Finally, I'd like to update the board on implementation of our new financial management system. So we have several slides here. I was hoping to be able to log in and demonstrate some of the capabilities, but it looks like we have some challenges perhaps with internet access in chambers. So I'm just going to speak to the PowerPoint presentation. We envisioned this as a two-year process. The first year we would do financials, and the second year we would do HR and payroll, and that's exactly the path that we have been on. We went live with a general ledger, accounts payable, purchasing, budget, project and grant accounting, school activity funds July 1 of 2016. That was the first phase. And of course, we built our budget inside of Munis for the first time with focusing on the non-payroll components because we're not using the payroll module yet. It was not possible for us to use that to build the FY18 budget, but that is absolutely how we will build the FY19 budget. Our applicant tracking went live this week, and so that has been a separate application for us. Now that's going to be integrated into our financial management HR system. Folks that were currently in our Winocular system will not have to move their information over, but we started using the new system this week. We will begin payroll processing, which is really exciting, in June with our first payroll to go live in August of this current school year. So we're really excited about that. But the thing that we are most excited about is what's on the very last page, and that's our employee self-service module. Our employees will have access to a tremendous amount of information that they can manipulate, it's going to save a lot of paper. The two photos that are there are all the paper that we processed to do the our payroll last month in the boxes, right? There won't be any of that when we go live with a new system because all of the payroll sheets and everything will be submitted electronically. Timesheets will be submitted electronically. So all employees will have access to their personal information and a mechanism for being able to change that. Some of that information will require a supporting documentation be submitted to HR. Their pay stubs and W-2s will all be in there. There'll be a paycheck simulator, which is really cool. They'll be able to go in, and if they want to change their number of deductions or during open enrollment want to change the health insurance plan they have, they'll be able to do that, hit the simulate button, and it will show them what the change will be in their compensation, their take home. So they can make some decisions about what level of coverage they might want or the amount of number of deductions that they have. They'll be entering timesheets that will have to be approved by supervisors, but supervisors will be able to approve the timesheets either through their computer or through an application that will be on their phone, which is pretty interesting. They'll request leave in that same manner. So whether it's sick leave or professional leave or whatever that is, they'll be able to do it online. Supervisors will be able to see everybody that reports to them and what their requests look like as an aggregate to make a decision as to whether or not they might be in a position to approve that request or not. So if it's a personal leave kind of thing and it looks like we've got too many folks that are asking for that on a particular day, you'll be able to see that all in a snapshot. Expense reports, so folks will request reimbursements in a similar manner electronically. And then we've already spoken to the changes in withholding and open enrollment. We think it's a kind of a one-stop shop for everybody to do pretty much anything they have to do in engaging with us. Employees will also have access to their evaluations in the system as well. So that's kind of where we are right now. I'd be happy to respond to any questions.
Any questions, Mr. Benson? Dr. Benson? Wow, no questions. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
At this time, I'd like to welcome Julia Hammond up here to give us some updates on our legislative agenda, maybe our future legislative agenda.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Vice Chair, and board members. Julia Carlo Hammond on the firm of Eckert Siemens on behalf of myself and my colleague, David Clark. It was a real pleasure representing you before the Virginia General Assembly this year. We also greatly appreciate the time of the legislative committee members, staff, and the dedicated personnel in each department who were able to give their time and their talent to us as we not only pursued the five legislative initiatives that you all approved, but in addition to the hundreds of bills that we tracked on your behalf, making sure that the implications for Stafford were always known as we were either testifying or attempting to work on the measures. So thank you. As for the five legislative initiatives approved by the board, they were well standards, Lake Mooney tax deferral, surviving spouse tax exemption, Lake Arrowhead dam repairs, and public day school funding. For the first one, well standards, the legislation ended up being tabled in committee. Senator Stewart was our patron. And the reason it was tabled was there is an ongoing study happening by DEQ with results due early fall. And the committee members thought that were concerned about action ahead of the end of the report and wanting to make sure they had all of the facts ahead of time. So the measure was tabled. It'll be once the results are in, we will meet with staff and legislators to see what actions they foresee going forward and report back to you so that you guys can decide how you want to proceed going forward. But there was no policy position taken on the merits of the legislation. It was rather just put on hold until the study results were in. On the Lake Mooney real property tax referral, our patrons were Delegates Dudenheffer and Senator Stewart. The bill allows for Stafford to adopt a deferral program by ordinance to provide tax relief for property owners surrounding Lake Mooney. That legislation has passed, has been signed by the governor, and will go into effect July 1. There was quite a bit of negotiations going back and forth. Many members of the General Assembly were interested, again, not in a negative sense, but recognizing that this could be precedent setting for the rest of the Commonwealth and wanted to make sure that they knew everything that they were doing going forward. The Commissioner of the Revenue was incredibly helpful, providing testimony and explaining the practical implication of the bill for Stafford County. And in the end, it enjoyed great support in both bodies of the General Assembly. The surviving spouse real property tax exemption was a constitutional amendment sponsored by Senator Stewart. As you know, with a constitutional amendment, it must pass twice in identical form with an election in between before it can go on to the ballot. The legislation had no issues passing through the Senate, but once it made it over to the House side, a delegate Miares from Virginia Beach, had similar but different legislation. Ours sought to expand the benefit from killed in action to those killed in action or who otherwise died in a combat zone. The Miares Amendment keeps killed in action language, but extended the tax relief to surviving spouses, regardless of their principal place of residence. And that was is too far for members of the Legislative Committee, and so they voted to withdraw support for the measure. The bill did pass the House with those amendments, was put into a conference committee, and then again, rather than taking any kind of negative statement as to what the goal of Stafford was, the bill was left in the conference committee, so there was no negative action taken on the measure. Should you decide to pursue this again, we would not be able to move forward on a constitutional amendment until the 2019 session, again, with that two-year passage and the election in between rules. Delegate Meares's resolution will have to pass the General Assembly again in identical form next year before it can make it on the ballot. The fourth measure, Lake Arrowhead state-mandated repairs, this legislation sought to change who can qualify for specific DCR funds, and with Delegate Cole was our bill patron, with his help and negotiation back and forth and some very helpful lobbying from board members who were able to come down for VACO Lobby Day, the measure passed the General Assembly. The governor did send down some minor tweaks to the bill, technical amendments only, and because they were received prior to session adjourning and accepted by the General Assembly, the bill is already in effect. We did not have to wait for his action during the bill review period, so that has passed and will go into effect July 1 as well. The last piece, public day school funding, which has obviously been an issue for the board for several years, we took a two-pronged approach. One was the legislation that has been introduced every year, and the second one was to work through the budget. We knew that there was action. There were other members who had budget amendments looking to move the funding and really change the program, and ours was very narrowly tailored, specific to Stafford County's needs for public day school funding. What ended up happening in the end was the General Assembly, through the Money Committee staff, have convened a work group with reports due to the chairs November of this year. So they will decide the action going forward. Stafford County has submitted a letter, and it has been well received, and we will have a role to play in that committee. Specifically, staff will have the opportunity to present their our Stafford's way, which is more cost-effective and is able to benefit the children in their own community. So the goal would be, assuming you all approve next year, to move forward with the final results, but again, for the direct benefit of Stafford County students. Those are the five initiatives. Tomorrow is the reconvened session where the General Assembly will act on all of the governor's measures, his vetoes, his amendments to bills, and then the 27 amendments he sent down to the state budget. We have been working with your association, VACO, in working on those amendments, et cetera, but nothing is happening to any of the Stafford County specific legislation. We have gone through this whole process without really too much brouhaha, and the governor had absolutely no qualms with any of our legislation. So from a county perspective, I would say we fared very well. From a legislative, there are some cleanup items. But again, most of his actions were made to the benefit or following the requested position of VACO and VML, the Virginia Municipal League. If there are any questions on it or your bill tracking chart, tomorrow, once they have adjourned, we will recirculate the chart with the final disposition of all of the bills that were of interest to board members, and they were color-coded, so hopefully they'll be easy for you to digest because it is 70 pages long.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Ms. Sellers.
I've been on this committee every year since I got elected, so this was my fourth time, and by far working with you and David, it was night and day. The best. We got the feedback. We got the charts. It took a little bit of stress, and I don't want to speak for our staff members, but it took a little bit of stress off of our staff members who were in the past were doing the charts and the templates, where you guys took that over, and so it was very much appreciated. Next year should be fun. The day school bill, regardless of what it looks like up here with five of us potentially leaving, I hope we continue fighting that fight in Richmond and telling them it's an important policy decision that they need to change.
Ms. Bonke?
Yes, I just want to thank you all also, and I want to thank Supervisor Maurer and Sellers for all their hard work. You guys kept us in the loop all the time, and that was really important, and staff did do a tremendous amount of work, but not like in previous years. And I want to thank Anthony Tiago as well. Because he really jumped in and really, when I happened to be in the office, he was working on some legislative issues, and I think he found it very invigorating. But you all did a great job, and thank you to my colleagues.
Mm-hmm. Ms. Maurer.
So I think we're going to expand the aperture next year, you know, with the blessing of the rest of the board. But there are some issues that the schools are having difficulty with, cost of competing, some of the unfunded mandates. Mm-hmm. And so I just wanted to let you know it's going to be more than five next year, because we are inviting them to the table to make sure that we take their concerns to the General Assembly as well.
Any other comments or questions? Thank you very much, and to your team, for all your hard work.
Thank you very much.
For the session. That brings us to presentations by the public. Is there anyone in the room that would like to address the board? I know, and I think I am obligated to say that. You'll notice I didn't go into the details. All right. With that, I will close the presentation by the public section of this meeting and bring it back to committee reports by board members.
Ms. Sellers?
I'll keep it short. This past 2 weeks, the two of the most interesting things I did in the last 2 weeks is I got to see the high school students up here doing government day, but also the third graders. Came up here Friday afternoon or morning around lunchtime, and there were these little third graders sitting through the very similar presentations that the high school students were doing. And, you know, they get to sit up here and they can barely see over the dais, but it's very, very cute to watch, and I hope it inspires some of those young kids to come into public office, because it is important. And I want to thank all of our staff who helped put that together, to listen to them interact. I sat with them through the sheriff's department's presentation, and it's very interesting to hear them go back and forth in the message. So that's really, really important. So thank you to all the staff. The other meeting that I had, which is near and dear to all of our hearts, behind stormwater management is traffic concerns. I held a community meeting last week with Austin Ridge, some folks there, and so they are also concerned with the number of vehicles coming down their roads and speeding, and so we have talked about the signs, that the speed signs that we're going to put up, and hopefully we can gather support for that. Ms. Baumke brought it up, but that's all I have.
That was short.
Mr. Snellings.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. I attended that Crow's Nest trail opening with Ms. Baumke and Chairman Mildy. Very impressive. That's an 8-mile trail, and I encourage people that want to get a little exercise, that's the place to go. It's not the place to go if you're practicing for a 5K run or a bicycle race. That's not it. This is a nature walk, and believe me, it's something to see. And just to clear up a little confusion, I've had a couple calls from people saying that they didn't get invited, and why didn't we invite them? Reality is the county had no input on that at all. It was all done by the state, and they invited who they wanted, and I was very fortunate enough to get an invitation to it. If you came in the back way today, you will see that work has begun on the Armed Services Memorial. They started on it this week, which is very exciting. Just a couple things there. If you want to have a commemorative brick for the grand opening on July the 15th, you must purchase it by May the 1st in order to get it in there. You'll be able to purchase it after that, but if you purchase it after May 1st, it will not be there on grand opening day. If the board remembers 4 or 5 weeks ago, we fenced off $117,000 to help the committee, the memorial committee, or guarantee funding so they could put some additions on. I'm happy to say that we're down now to $85,000. And I'm totally confident we will collect the entire amount. So thank the board for all your support. And here again, buy a brick.
Thank you. Congratulations.
Mr. Thomas.
Thank you very much. We had a Community and Economic Development Committee meeting today. Some of the topics that rise to the top. We had a interesting discussion about food and agricultural resources and a regional approach to making sure that we preserve land, which of course is a priority of this board, but also figure out how to connect farmers and consumers and make sure we have a vibrant agricultural sector of our economy. More to follow on that. I think the body has briefed us first, and they're gonna brief a couple of other localities in the region and probably come back with a funding request at some point. We had an update from the executive director of the Quantico Innovation Center, which was very good to hear. I think he's been on the job 5 months, and he's hit the ground running and brought us an update today. We also discussed the possible change to our merchants' capital tax. There's a proposal to eliminate 25% of that tax from the current budget. And let's see, we also talked about an ordinance change to the PDR program. Right now, you have to have 20 acres of property to make an application. And the proposed ordinance change that you'll probably see at some point very soon would remove that 20-acre requirement as long as it was contiguous to a previously PDR'd property. So this would allow you to expand an existing PDR property if you already have it in the system. And then we also discussed a proposal for an RFP. We haven't really figured out what the title of the job is yet, but as everyone knows, for many, many years, a goal of the board is to have a downtown Stafford or a Stafford Town Center. And with the addition of possibly a new courthouse in the coming years, Mr. Foley has brought, I think, some pretty forward-leaning ideas that he's used in previous localities to bring in some experts to help us see the vision of downtown Stafford. As you know, the government can't do it on our own, but we need private partners to come partner up with us. So I think you'll be hearing more from Mr. Foley on that, and the board will be making some decisions hopefully very soon. That's my report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Ms. Baumke?
Yes, I attended the quarterly Rappahannock River Basin meeting at the England Run Library. We had Kevin Utt from the city of Fredericksburg who gave us a presentation on brownfields, which are basically fields that are businesses that have been contaminated by hazardous waste, and you can apply for grants and take that commercial development and turn it into a valued property. I don't think it's anything we've done here in Stafford yet. I also attended with Chief Lockhart and Supervisor Milday the NAACP event, and we had the assistant fire chief from Prince George's County, Dana Brooks, who spoke, which was great. And her speech was about the word RISE, which stands for Respect, Inspire, Service, and Excellence. And she had a lot to say, and that all resonated with us. It was a nice event, as usual, that they hold. I wanted to say that Chief Lockhart did an excellent job at the 2016 Fire and Rescue Department Service Awards Banquet at the Eagles Lodge, congratulating all the career and volunteer firefighters. And a special thank you to our Kimberly, I think I'm pronouncing her name correctly, Borson, whose three-year-old daughter has a rare disease, and unfortunately, or fortunately, the Fire and Rescue Department has gotten to know her very well and her family. They've been to the home multiple times. So that was a little bit of a tearjerker, but she had nothing but great things to say about our Fire and Rescue Department. I had a meeting with Kim McClellan from the Fredericksburg Area Association of Realtors to discuss the sign ordinance. As you can imagine, the realtors continue to be concerned about what we are going to consider a temporary sign. And I know we have a lot of people down in Richmond today at the sign seminar meeting that they're having for the entire state. So that will be interesting to see what they come back with. I also participated in the first annual juried art show at the downtown Marriott. This was a presentation of 50 masks that were primarily made by adults, and each mask had a title, and it described the artist's thinking about sexual assault. And all I can tell you is it was unbelievable. The masks are all going to be displayed in downtown restaurants, and then they'll be you'll have an opportunity to see them again in September at an event. And the other reason I bring this up is I wanted to say a big shout out to the Mountain View Quartet for coming and singing. These were all high school juniors, and their music was unbelievable. And I'd just like to announce who the students were. It was juniors David Cohen, Paige Dortler, Lauren Bristow, and Alex Garvey. And they were all accompanied by Tom McDonald, their director. And especially their, the event revolved around a not-so-exciting topic of sexual assault, and it was really nice to have the music. I also just wanted to echo what Mr. Milday just said regarding the Crow's Nest event. I just happened to ask a friend who was there. I said, hey, what's your connection to this? He said, I used to write op-eds for the newspaper 15 years ago fighting for this property to be preserved. And I had no idea. I knew them from a different venue in the community. So it's just really interesting what has taken place in the history behind Crow's Nest. And somebody like me, I really didn't know the whole story. And then lastly, I'd just like to report on our infrastructure meeting. We discussed the STARS project, which we're going to be looking at through FAMPO in conjunction with VDOT. And we also talked about, as Ms. Sellers mentioned, the pole-mounted speed display signs. We have asked staff to go back to the drawing board and come back to us with some additional information. And we also tabled the Mount Olive sewer extension and until a later date. So there was a vote of the committee, and it was voted 3-0 to table that until another meeting. That's all I have. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Cavalier.
Thank you. Just a few quick items. I attended the Quail Harbor Property Owners Association board meeting with Mr. Milday. I also went to the Widewater Beach Civic Association annual meeting, and they do it outside there at the their marina pavilion, and it was a little chilly that day, but it's nice being on the water. Some of the key issues there that I think are issues in a lot of the rural parts of the county. One is the lack of broadband service. They really are in need of high-speed internet out there. And so there was a gentleman there who retired from Verizon and said that when they were running the lines there, that there is actual lines run along the railroad track. And so if we could look into where that terminus is, so that, because that's not as too far a distance from their community, and if we can hook into that, perhaps that's a viable alternative to what they have out there right now, which is just satellite coverage. Also want to discuss they're really happy that we're going to get full-time career staffing here very soon at Company 3 for fire and rescue purposes. That's a big quality of life thing for them being so far out. And they did reiterate the need for a fireboat, which I keep preaching almost every meeting. And we'll talk about that in the CIP part of the discussion tonight. But and the last thing is the transportation was a big issue out there. And Widewater Road is in need of repair. And VDOT is scheduled to perform that resurfacing here this fall. So we're making progress there in the rural part of the county. And I attended the executive committee meeting of the Quantico Innovation Center last week, as well as I visited Brook Point High School classroom, Ms. Ellis's marketing class, I think it was. I think they have a fancy name for it, though, with Dr. Benson, and actually learned some things in there. So it was very informative, and that concludes my report. Thank you.
Mrs. Maurer?
Well, actually, it was kind of a slow couple of weeks. I attended the Gables Homeowners Association and really appreciate the Homeowners Association's reaching out and asking me to come visit with them and let them know what's going on in the county. Also want to thank VDOT for putting in a crosswalk. They are right across the street from both Mountain View and Margaret Brent Elementary School, and so that crosswalk was very much appreciated that got installed. Also attended with my colleagues, Ms. Sellers and Mr. Snellings, the Student Government Day here in our board chambers. And it's really great to see our high school students participating in mock board sessions discussing issues that may or may not come before this board. It was an amazing amount of participation by everybody involved, and I especially want to thank Tom Cohen. He's been doing this for 14 years. He is a teacher at Colonial Forge, a government teacher at Colonial Forge. He also sits on our planning commission, and he does a great job with that program, and he truly takes it to heart. Also attended the ribbon cutting and welcomed a First Family Dental into Stafford County, and they're on the western end of 610, which will be much appreciated to a lot of my western constituents because there is very little commercial development. They've got to come quite far in. So thank you for joining Stafford County and for expanding your practice. They're currently in Spotsylvania as well. And also attended the Habitat for Humanity Blitz Build. This was something that I did when I first got on the board. There was an odd restriction preventing Habitat for Humanity from building on a lot out in Lake Arrowhead. And a year later, it is really amazing to see Ebenezer Church, which I'm very grateful for, their veteran build group, get out there. And in 3 days, they took that house from foundation to completely under roof in the torrential rainstorm that we had on Friday. And so they had more than 70 volunteers out there, and I am looking forward to the ribbon cutting and welcoming Army veteran Amanda and her 4 children into the Stafford County community. If you really, this job, I often say it's the most meaningful work I've ever done in my entire life, and being able to touch someone like that and give them a new lease on life, it is just truly an honor and quite humbling, quite frankly. And finally, I was hoping that our county, we have a new sign ordinance, and we are officially the start of election season, and I want to wish all of my colleagues well. I wouldn't change your position for anything in the world, but I think it's important that we get out to all of our new candidates and our party leaders the changes in our sign ordinance, because it will affect this election season. So if staff could take care of that, I'd really appreciate it. And I also have a World War II veteran up there on 610 who allows everybody to put a sign up, and he is now limited to 3. So I'm not quite sure how involved he is on this sign ordinance change, and I think it's really important given his age, and it doesn't matter if you're a Republican or a Democrat. If you're running for office, you get to put a sign on his property. So if we could also make a visit to him and let them know, because he would get cited and not the campaigns. So that's all I have to say. Thank you very much.
And Mr. Milday.
Thank you. To the sign ordinance, quickly, I'll say 2 things. I've always been a kind of a proponent of tightening up our sign ordinance, which may not be what everyone's view is here, but just you'll notice when you see signs, what is not legal, no matter what we do here, are things in the right-of-way. If you're under power lines or against in a median or in an area that's right next to a road or a railroad track, that is probably an illegal sign. When this ordinance comes back, and we'll have a chance to talk about it, but since it's come up a couple of times, I want to caution the board about allowing permanent signs up to a certain size in anyone and everyone on everyone's piece of property. That is how we decided to address the real estate sellers' concerns, and that is not how other counties are doing it. Fredericksburg is not going that route, and Alexandria did not go that route. You have to have your property listed or for rent or for sale, and upon investigation, you would be able to determine if a sign was there for that reason. I think that's a better way to go. I hope we consider that. As you heard, I was at a lot of different events with different members. Also, Ms. Bomke and Wendy Maurer forgot to mention, I think, that we were at a FAMPO meeting also. That was a meeting in Fredericksburg dealing with transportation. I did attend the QUIC meeting that Mr. Cavalier attended, as well as a subcommittee QUIC meeting a couple of days before that. And this morning, I attended the Fredericksburg Chamber of Commerce roundtable they have occasionally. It's really always a great morning event. This one was at the Marriott downtown. And I got to listen to Tim Baruti speak to the crowd, and he's really doing well in that position. And I was also at that Fire and Rescue Awards banquet. That was a great event. Yeah, I love that you were awarding volunteers as well as paid staff, and everyone really seemed to be grateful for that. So thank you. And that ends my comments. Excuse me, of course, to the county attorney who...
And I will defer any comments. Thank you very much, Mr.
Thank you.
Chairman.
And Mr. County Administrator, Tom Foley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a few brief updates. Did want to keep you on track with the joint CIP process that's being developed. That is going before the Joint Schools Working Committee on Monday. As a final draft from staff, that school and local government staff working together, they are scheduled to move that onto a joint FAB meeting in May, and then it will be before you all in June. So that is on schedule at this point. Shared services evaluation is getting underway with a staff team over the next month or so. Over the course of the summer, you'll get some updates on that to see what's been prioritized as other areas we can work together on. So we will keep you up to date on that as well. The Deputy County Administrator hiring process, just wanted you to know that we have been through our first round of interviews and are at the top three candidates. I appointed a committee to do the first round of staff, and the top candidates will be coming to me over the next couple weeks. And when we've gotten to a top candidate, I hope on the 18th to introduce them to you in closed session, give you a chance to say hello and ask them a few questions. But that's where we are with that process. I'm certainly anxious to get that individual on board as soon as possible, so we're working towards that. I did want to give you a quick update. Not that I would do this all the time, but on a couple things that are going on that I think are important because of the transition and changes that we've had in the county over the last year or so with leadership team members as well as other folks moving into different roles. As it relates to our leadership team development, wanted you to know that over the next few months, we'll be planning an offsite meeting, all-day meeting with our leadership team, hopefully after we get our new county administrator, assistant county administrator on board. That will be to take a look at our values and vision, our leadership philosophy as an organization. I think some real important work as we form this new leadership team that's going to serve the citizens going forward. Also, as it relates to employee engagement, we will be conducting a climate survey of all the county staff sometime over the next few months. Leadership team and our employee advisory committee will be getting together to develop a survey so that we can take a pulse of our workforce and see how things are going and what we might do to continue to enhance morale and service in the county. I think Dr. Benson has talked about some of that work being done in the school system before. That is actually a regular practice that excellent organizations go about. So we're going to put some extra effort into that over the next few months. Again, I wouldn't normally talk about all this, but because of all the transition, I just wanted you to know some of the things that are going on internal to the organization to build our team. And Mr. Chairman, that's all that I had.
Thank you. And I believe our agenda is intact. Oh, Mr. Cavalier.
Tom, do you have an update on the contracts administrator position? I know we have the authority to proceed with that from the joint schools working group, and you said you had a number of qualified candidates. I just wanted to know where we were.
Yeah, you know, I don't have the latest, but on Monday we were going to give a full update on that. That process has moved along in its typical fashion, so I think we're ready to make a hire pretty soon, but I just don't have the latest. But it is on the agenda for the Joint Schools Working Group on Monday.
Any other questions? All right. I think our agenda is intact. We don't have to do a vote on the agenda. So would I ask if anyone wants to pull anything off of the consent?
Item number 9.
I knew that was coming. So we'll pull item number 9.
I'd like to pull item number 10 as well.
Number 10 as well. Any others? All right. I'll entertain a motion for the consent agenda minus items number 9 and 10.
Second.
I have moved and seconded. Please find your gadget and cast your vote. Oh, there we go. And you may tally the votes. I voted aye, but here we go. Let's try that again. I the vote, chair votes aye. Okay, here we go. And that passes unanimously. Ms. Sellers, item number 9.
So I just pulled this off because I intend to vote against it, but I have no other comments at this time.
My district, I will move item number 9.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Please cast your votes. Tally the votes. This passes 6-1. Ms. Sellers, number 10.
Yeah, I pulled this off just because I want to make sure this young man gets as much notoriety as possible. This is a huge accomplishment at such a young age to be chosen to go and do one of these Senate youth programs, which in the past have been on the chopping blocks to cut in the previous years. The House of Representatives no longer has it. So the fact that he's up there and that, you know, it's always one of the programs that could be cut, I just want to make sure this young man gets the proper notoriety. And it's not my district, so the high school is, but the child lives in a different district, so I won't make the motion.
We grow them smart in Hartwood.
Second.
Is that is a motion, right, Mr. Snellings? Okay, I have a motion by Mr. Snellings and seconded. Please cast your votes. And tally the votes. Oh, my goodness. All right, there we go. And that passes unanimously. And that brings us to new business. Public Works, discuss the Mountain View Road, Stefanica Road intersection.
Mr. Chairman, I ask that this be put on the agenda. Ms. Maurer and I are getting a lot of complaints, and rightfully so, with this intersection at Stefanica and Mountain View. It is being used as a cut-through by the students every morning. I've been up there several times. I know she has as well, and believe me, it is a very dangerous intersection. It's hard to see to get out. It's hard to get out, period. VDOT has turned down a three-way stop. They've got some kind of engineering problem with it, but reality is I thought if I elevated it to the board, maybe we could get this to infrastructure and find maybe an alternative means, maybe some funding. I think Ms. Sellers mentioned that there's some grant money through FAMPO.
One of the ideas I brought to him was Hap Connors, where's Mike Smith, that group where Hap is asking for us to bring extra projects for district grant funds. This is really early, but we could put it on the table, see if he'd be willing to look at it, entertain it.
Are you proposing a new interchange?
No, to go look at it.
VDOT is already, they're going to improve the interchange at some point in time. I'd like to get speeded up. What they're going to do now is just go out and cut vegetation so you can see a little bit better, but it's still dangerous. So my thought process and Ms. Maurer's thought process is if we get it to the board, let's get it into infrastructure and see if we can find some alternatives to move that interchange restructuring up, get it done quicker rather than later.
Mm-hmm. Ms. Pompke, you have a problem with that?
No, I don't have a problem with that because it seemed like in the board write-up that anything that you're looking at right now are all temporary fixes.
That's correct.
Yeah.
All right.
And just for clarification, the Smart Scale, we didn't get any money in Smart Scale. So we went to Mr. Connors and we had a big issue with that. We've talked about it several times. We pretty much got nothing this year.
We got something from Smart Scale. We just didn't get.
Okay, we basically got nothing this year. And so take it to him and see if there's a way we could get CTB to at least entertain it. It doesn't hurt to try.
Tens of millions of dollars on our VRE lots, for one thing, and some of the smaller projects, I believe. Just so you know, I just want to be clear that we didn't get what we wanted, which is the $130 million northbound road.
Not a single one of our road projects was.
Ms. Mallon?
So I have, I've received several emails on this. People have seen it on our agenda. I even had a young Boy Scout call me last night to discuss this particular interchange as part of his Eagle project and his community service involvement badge that he has to do. So this is getting elevated, and it is very dangerous. And the part that's really dangerous, there are a couple of temporary fixes. One is doing the vegetation, but even if we could help that grade is pretty steep, that even in an automatic, I roll back before I can move forward and make that left-hand turn. It is definitely a intersection that is used by our students at Mountain View and at Colonial Forge. So they're looking at, you know, options to realign the road, but even if we could do something as small as help fix the grade before we get to the full-on realignment, I would really support those types of efforts. But it is incredibly dangerous for our kids that are on that road, and especially its proximity to Mountain View High School.
All right, let's move this into infrastructure at the next meeting. And while you're speaking of bad roads, I'd maybe an update on the James Hill Brook Road thing too. I meant to mention that in my comments. Any other comments on this item? All right, good. That's quick. Do we have a closed session? I don't see it on our agenda, but I think we had one item.
Yes,
we do. Mm-hmm. So want to take us into closed
Mr.
session?
Mr. Chair, I'd like to offer a resolution to authorize closed meeting, whereas the board desires to hold a closed meeting for discussion concerning the terms or scope of a public contract, where discussion in an open session would adversely affect the bargaining position or negotiating strategy of the board. Pursuant to Virginia Code 2.2-3711A29, this discussion may occur in a closed meeting.
Moved and seconded. Please cast your votes. Tally the votes. All right, that passes unanimously. We're going to go into closed session. And when we're finished there, we'll come back out and certify that we're out of closed session, and then we'll take a break until the 7 o'clock portion of our meeting. And we are back. I'll entertain a motion.
Motion to certify.
Second.
Motion and seconded. Please cast your votes. Tally the votes. And that passes unanimously. We are out of closed session, and we will take a break until 7 p.m. We'll be, see you back here. Good evening. This meeting, the Stafford County Board of Supervisors is called to order. Good evening, and thank you all for joining us here and at home. We're going to start with the invocation by Mr. Thomas and the Pledge of Allegiance by Ms. Bomke.
Please bow your heads. Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight seeking your wisdom and guidance, for we have the huge responsibility of directing the dollars of our friends and neighbors to needs within our community. Let us be wise and fair in the application of our budgets, and I pray that we meet as many needs of our community as possible. Be with the public this evening as they share their input with us, and be with my colleagues as we deliberate over the coming weeks on this important decision. We also pray for the safety of our armed forces and our public safety servants who are on the front lines for each of us each day. In his name we pray. Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, Shelby's, don't get comfortable. I'm going to invite you guys up here. Just him? I'm asking for all of you. Come on. Come on, Samer and Kathy. And Mr. Snellings, Supervisor Snellings. Mazin is a remarkable young man. That's the younger of the three coming up. Who has achieved a great deal in a short time. He was recently informed that he was selected to be a Jefferson Scholar at the University of Virginia. This prestigious award includes a full scholarship to UVA. He has also been accepted to Yale, Duke, Rice University, and the College of William and Mary. He received the C. Dan Keffer Scholarship, the top honor awarded by the Virginia State Golf Association, VIP Scholarship Foundation. As well, he loves helping with Special Olympics and being a big brother with Rappahannock area big brothers and sisters. Welcome, Mazin. And I'm going to turn this over to Supervisor Snellings.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's quite an honor for me, to get this achievement at such a young age. Three things have to happen. Number one, you have to have parents that will get behind their son or daughter and make sure it happens. Number two, you need a young man like this with the drive and the commitment and the discipline to make sure it happens. And number three, you need a good school. And all three came together, and I tell you, I'm very proud to present you tonight this proclamation on behalf of the board. Wish you much success. Hope you get into school. Well, you've already gotten in all the schools. Hope you choose the one that's best for your mom and dad's wallet.
Mazin, you want to say a few words?
This went so well. Just couldn't have got here without the help and support of everyone. We're all working to help better the community and the school system, and of course, our parents. In so many ways, we'd not be here without them. So just thank you, and can't emphasize enough. Fund the schools.
Oh boy, I shouldn't have asked. Thank you. That's what I get for asking. Just kidding. And we do. All right. Next, we're going to do presentations by the public. This is a time we can come address the board on an issue that's not on one of our public hearings. Excuse me. So if it's not on the agenda, this is the time to come up and speak about it to the board. You have 3 minutes. And when you get the yellow light, you have 1 minute left. After you've stated your name and address, you start. 2 minutes later, you get the yellow light. And after a minute passes, you'll be red lighted and it'll be time to sit down. So is anyone here that would like to speak to us about something other than a public hearing item? And Mrs. Callender.
Good evening. Elaine Callender, 622 Lancaster Street in Falmouth. I must say I was quite taken aback to hear comments by board members today at the afternoon meeting. Governor McAuliffe for not inviting all the important players involved in the preservation effort to the grand opening of Crow's Nest. That was an event coordinated between the Department of Natural Resources and Stafford County Government. I think that surely Stafford County provided names and addresses to Richmond so invitations could be sent. I don't know who put together the invitation list, but deserving individuals were left off. I don't know if that's because of the transition period to a new county administrator, because people in the administrative offices are new, or because politics entered into the picture. But hopefully the newspapers will tell the whole story of how dedicated citizens worked for many years to reveal to the world the glory of Crow's Nest and how elected officials of all political persuasions work to find the funds to protect this precious natural resource. Let's give credit where credit is due and recognize all who contributed to the end result of having an accessible nature area for all to enjoy and protect. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to address the board? All right, I will close presentations by the public and bring us to our public hearings. Right, item 15. Where are we in this?
Chair,
we're going to have a presentation at all?
To move right towards the public comment.
All right, so we're not going to do any type of presentation before we open a public hearing for. Okay. All right, this is my first time doing a public hearing for.
Mine too.
So
my understanding.
We're kind of new at
yes,
this.
Sir.
All right, so do you want to read us into it, or how would you just board us? It's the agenda item that's proposed year 2017 tax rates, FY 2018 county budgets, FY 2018 to 27 capital improvements program. And with that, I will open the floor to anyone that would like to comment on that agenda item.
Mr. Chairman, I think you have a speaker's list, possibly.
Of course, thank you. Well, I'm blowing it. Okay, here we go. We do have a speaker's list. And for this item, my first speaker is Janelle Donahue. Janelle, hey, one of these days I'll get something right.
You're doing a great job. Keep it up.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Janelle Donahue. I'm the president of Rappahannock United Way, and I just wanted to come tonight, and I wanted to say thank you. Thank you so much. Last year, you funded a grant to Rappahannock United Way for $2,700, and we are very grateful for that. And I wanted to share a little bit about what we have done with that donation. Volunteer services, community resources, and a financial stability initiative are just three of the things that we were able to focus on. We connected 450 Stafford residents with volunteer opportunities and projects at local nonprofit organizations. We leveraged the time and talents of Stafford volunteers at an average of $23 per hour, which means $1,000. And many Stafford County government employees also participate in our Days of Action, one of their favorite activities to help promote volunteerism in our community and make impact. Community resources. This is really helpful to your county. Vital information on local programs and services through 211, a free and non-emergency number that provides an access to where the resources are in our community. Our goal is to get the information they need and understand where to go get the information when they need them. In addition, we have a program and a software called Charity Tracker that allows local agencies providing direct assistance to residents to share information, identify resources, needs, and ensure the limited available are distributed fairly, as well as reducing duplication of services. So this is an immeasurable value to client management services and maximizes Stafford County's resources and reduces duplication of services right here in your county. And then financial stability initiative. We and financial education and coaching services to 530 Stafford residents and households each year. Now that's a saving of $120,000 in tax preparation fees. That's income in their pockets. Tax credits for Stafford households alone. We did over $1.9 million in tax refunds last year. Now, now, in addition, we've also worked with your Department of Social Services. We have trained you may wonder, $2,700, why are you coming to ask for that when you do over $3 million in fundraising on your own? Well, in order to do financial stability, they ask for federal, local, and state grants, and when we have you as a matching partner, we can and grants and back into our community. So it's not about the fundraising. It's about you being a partner to Rappahannock United Way. Do you get that return on investment anywhere else? $85,000 for $2,700 investment. Please continue to fund Rappahannock United Way, and thank you for what you do. Thank you.
I don't think I can mess this one up. Linda Hill.
Now, since we had breakfast together this morning at a chamber breakfast, I am now the executive director of Open Hand of Fredericksburg, and I'm delighted to be back here speaking to you again. You know where my passion is. But despite the wonderful young man we saw today, and I love that presentation, I want to ask you if any of you have ever said, kids today have no idea how to work. They don't even know what it means to do a good job and be a good employee. And whether you said it about your own family or friends, I think most of you have had that feeling. Well, I want to tell you, if you are a teenager in a low-income household, and maybe one in which English is not even the primary language spoken at home, you've got a lot bigger hill to climb, because a lot of these low-income teenagers do not have a role model at home. They don't sit down for dinner with somebody who's going to be discussing things that would let them understand what they really need to do in a world of work. And as a result, a lot more of them end up in social services, needing those services. Well, in Open Hand is a faith-based organization, and we try to tackle this problem with paid summer, that's money for the kids, paid summer internships coupled with a mandatory series of workshops in which we're able to teach them the kinds of skills they need both to be a good employee for this summer, and so the employer today will be happy with what has happened, but also our objective is to lay a foundation for a lifetime of sustainable employment, and we're dealing with juniors and seniors in high school. And the kinds of things that we do, I want to tell you quickly, in these workshops, there are finances, you know, things like how to open a bank account and how to balance a checkbook. There are a lot of people that need that help, I think. We teach them workshops on interpersonal skills, how to get along and be dependable and be the kind of employee you would like to have. But there's also, we do an exploration of their options, their post-secondary options. And some of them have not ever had anybody do this for them, whether it takes them to Germana or to Mary Washington or to VMI or somewhere else to see this is what college would be like, and then we deal with how you might go about getting the funds to go there, if that's what you choose to do, because there is not a one-size-fits-all for these kids. And then, given you would, if you know me, this would not surprise you.
Ms. Hill, I need you to...
Oh, it's end. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry. I think it would be a wise investment, the $8,000 that
we
asked for.
Thank you. If I wasn't, I didn't really give the directions twice, but the directions are the same here. When you come up and state your name, you'll get a green light. 2 minutes, you'll get a yellow light, and then you'll get a red light at that third minute. And you're wonderful. Don't worry about it. All right. Teresa Bowers, please.
Good evening, Board of Supervisors and County Administration. My name is Teresa Bowers, and I'm the Director of the Senior Visitors Program at Mental Health America of Fredericksburg, and I am a Stafford County resident. Thank you for the opportunity to speak with you this evening, and on behalf of the people that we serve, thank you for your past support of our organization and for your proposed funding for this year. Our Senior Visitors Program is the one that you may be most familiar with. The clients that we serve are senior citizens, most of whom still live in their own homes. They are often homebound due to a physical disability or a visual deficit. Most are socially isolated, and many have lost the connection to their local community, which are risk factors for depression in the elderly. The Senior Visitors Program provides a trained volunteer who makes a free, weekly, in-home visit for socialization and support services. Many of our senior clients who lack family and social support come to rely on their free senior visitor volunteer, whether that's for someone to talk to and maybe the only person that they see all week, or for help with a health or safety issue or running an errand. This supports the senior and the local economy in Stafford. I can't emphasize enough the impact that this program has on the lives of seniors who were once lonely and felt disconnected from their community before enrollment in the Senior Visitors Program. I also want to take this opportunity to thank you for your support in the proposed budget for our mental health helpline and our suicide prevention education programs. Our helpline is another free service that we offer that can be used by anyone of any age who is seeking more information about mental health resources. We maintain the only list of local licensed and certified mental health providers, in addition to local support groups and other mental health resources. Often our staff is the first person a helpline caller is telling about their depression or suicidal feelings or anxiety, and we help them find the resources that they need. Our suicide prevention education program started in 2014, where we began teaching local high school freshmen the signs and symptoms of depression and suicidal ideation in themselves or their friends, and more importantly, what to do about it, how to seek help. We teach kids that suicide is not a natural response to stress, and we share an acronym called ACT. They learn acknowledge, care, tell. Since then, we have been able to expand our education to include seventh grade students, and now we have a teen advisory council, and we host a free teen support group in our community. Our tagline at Mental Health America is changing minds, changing lives, and we know that when we change minds by providing mental health resources and education, we change and save lives. Thank you for helping to make Stafford a county where residents are receiving the mental health resources that they need. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Dana Klein.
First of all, I'd like to say thank you to all of you as well for all of the work that you do. Hello, my name is Dana Klein. I'm a Stafford County resident, and I also work for the Fredericksburg Regional Food Bank. I'm not here tonight to ask the board to increase its budget, but instead to change how funds are allocated to benefit our community. According to the current proposed budget, the county is considering providing one of our partner agency pantries with $64,000 in funding, while the food bank is being considered for about one quarter of that amount, or about $15,200. I request you switch the amounts to better meet the needs right here in Stafford. The food bank does not receive federal or state funding, and as the food hub for this region, we are dependent on outside resources such as this to provide food for the programs benefiting Stafford County. There are 13 Fredericksburg Regional Food Bank partner agency pantries providing for the needs of Stafford residents, to include St. Peter's Lutheran, Ramoth Baptist, Serve, Stafford Church of God, and the Stafford Seventh-day Adventist. Last year, through the pantry distribution program, our 13 partner agency pantries distributed over 421,000 pounds of food from the food bank to 6,900 county residents, providing over 351,000 meals right here in Stafford. The food bank stocks and provides for 3 mobile pantries here in Stafford. The mobile pantry provides direct food assistance, and last year, 41,000 meals through our 3 mobile pantry sites went out through Widewater Elementary, Stafford Junction, and North Stafford Church of Christ. We also love to feed our seniors. The Food for Life Brown Box program last year provided 272 Stafford seniors and disabled prepacked Food for Life boxes provided by the food bank each month to our 9 participating Stafford pantries. These 9 pantries help to distribute 58,000 pounds of fresh and non-perishable foods as well as toiletries each month to care for our Staffords and our seniors and our disabled. We feed kids through our Kids on the Go Summer Feeding. Kids on the Go Summer Feeding is located at 2 sites, the Garrison Wood Apartment Complex and Kate Waller Barrett School. These 2 sites provide over 1,200 Stafford students with meals during the summer to alleviate childhood hunger. Our Food for Families School Pantry program has school-based pantries at Drew Middle School, Falmouth Elementary, Hampton Oaks, as well as Stafford County Head Start and the Stafford School Board Office to provide families with a readily accessible source of emergency food and SNAP information. Last year, the Food for Families program provided over 8,000 pounds of food to 889 families, along with SNAP assistance to help families in crisis. To feed our hungry and food insecure, it takes 13 pantries, 3 mobile pantries, 9 Food for Life distribution pantries, 5 on-site school pantries, 2 summer feeding sites, and 14 club kids partners. You would not fund just one school, provide food to only one grocery store, or have only one supervisor to provide for this county. Please consider switching the proposed funding to help to go from helping just one pantry to helping the food bank to allow the food bank programs to grow and better meet the needs of all of our hungry. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Ann H. I'm going to say Klokner. You'll have to tell me if I got that right.
Close. I'm Ann Klokner, and I'm the Executive Director at Legal Aid Works. We've been serving Stafford County since 1973. We changed our name from Rappahannock Legal Services to Legal Aid Works. Different name, same mission. I really want to sincerely thank you for the support you've given us over the years. It matters a lot, and it makes a big difference. We're asking for level funding. We have 3 full-time attorneys and 1 part-time attorney in our Fredericksburg office, which covers 5 counties and 15 courts. We represent low-income people who need an attorney in civil legal matters. We help victims of domestic violence. We help people obtain unemployment benefits. We help people resolve landlord-tenant and foreclosure matters. We're the only agency providing this service. In your county, there are 6,171 eligible low-income persons who could qualify for our services. As an outside agency, we behave like an inside agency by helping county governments in 3 important ways. We take the strain off your social services safety net by lifting clients out of poverty with enforceable court orders of child and spousal support, as well as unemployment benefits that the clients would not otherwise have won without our intervention. We help the county court system run efficiently by helping those who can't afford an attorney, pro se litigants, those without an attorney, slow the system down considerably. And we also aid law enforcement by working with victims of violence to secure enforceable protective orders. We leverage your financial support to provide legal services that benefit your citizens. In the last fiscal year, 409 of your residents were assisted by our 4 attorneys, including several critical domestic violence cases. We obtained $104,000 in annualized child and spousal support and avoided $5,000 in unlawful fees, fines, and debts for our clients. When you total the amount of real, measurable financial help we give our residents compared to the amount that you give us, that's an excellent return on your investment. your county's poor citizens received over $109,000 in enforceable court orders and avoided additional costs. In the last fiscal year, the three offices of our agency obtained nearly $1 million for our clients throughout the 17 counties that we serve with just nine lawyers. I have brought brochures with me tonight, not only to let you know about our new name, but also so that you can provide good constituent services by referring appropriate residents of this county to our office. Again, thank you for your role in achieving the American ideal of justice for all. You said justice for all when you did the Pledge of Allegiance. Now you get to walk the walk and talk the talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Klockner. John Gray.
Good evening. My name is John Gray, and I am a student at North Stafford High School and a member of the Self-Advocacy and Independent Living Program at Disability Resource Center. I am here today to, to thank the Board of Supervisors for all their support in the past and to ask that you please consider supporting the Disability Resource Center again this year. Disability Resource Center is one of 16 centers for independent living in the state of Virginia. We offer a variety of services to help people with disabilities. Some of the core services are independent living skills, training, peer counseling, information and referral. We also have an additional services for the deaf and the hard of hearing, health and wellness, and a Wednesday afternoon live group. We also offer youth services, personal assistance services, and family individual supports and waiver case management. Some of the things I like about the program is reconnecting with an old friend. I get to talk about my problems and learning more about my disability and how to be successful. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Gray. Next is Jack Lanier.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the Board of Supervisors. I'm Jack Lanier, and I want to thank you for the opportunity to present to you this evening on behalf of Quinn Rivers Community Action Agency. I provided a packet of information for your review at an appropriate time. I realize that you won't have time while I'm speaking, but the information that I have included in your packet is a copy of our annual report. It's a profile report fact sheet on what we do for Stafford County. Quinn Rivers is a Virginia-based nonprofit organization, a community action agency that provides leadership and support to advance the well-being of residents living in Central Virginia. Our area includes over 500,000 residents from Charles City County on the south to Stafford on the north. Prior to this year, we have not been involved in your budgeting process, and we requested $3,500 this year to allow us to expand one of our signature programs called Project Discovery into Colonial Forge High School. So my purpose is to introduce you to Quinn Rivers and what the agency does to help those in need. There are three specific programs. One is housing counseling, which assists individuals struggling with mortgage payments or who have the inability to manage their personal finances. We have a financial literacy program that has assisted any number of individuals, and primarily in the Fredericksburg office, where we have a satellite office, even though the primary office is located in New Kent. Second program is that of supportive services for veteran families. I'm a veteran myself, so I know how difficult it is for some veterans, particularly those who are at risk of becoming homeless. The third program is that of Project Discovery, which is a post-secondary access and preparatory program currently offered through Virginia. to students, grades 4 through 12. Project Discovery encourages students to stay in and graduate from high school and provides resources and tools for students to successfully make the transition to post-secondary education. Finally, I'd like to remind you that two members of our board of directors include Mr. Michael Muse, who's director of Stafford County Social Services, and also Mr. Michael Campbell, who's a retired veteran, Marine Corps, who lives in Stafford County. We are delighted to have others, volunteers, who are serving on our Project Discovery Advisory Council, which is a requirement in order for us to participate in Project Discovery Virginia. Delighted that I had the opportunity to speak, and we appreciate any support that you see fit to provide to Quinn Rivers Community Action Agency. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, thank you, sir. Our next speaker is Michelle Hedrick.
Honorable ladies and gentlemen of the board, county administrator and staff, my name is Michelle Hedrick. I'm the executive director of Rappahannock Big Brothers Big Sisters, so proud to have Mazin here tonight. I want to thank you for your past support. The Rappahannock Big Brothers Big Sisters Board of Directors asked the Board of Supervisors to approve the proposed level funding request of $6,000. This will help us to continue to recruit, interview, and enroll children, recruit, interview, and train new volunteer mentors, conduct volunteer background checks, create matches for children with mentors, and supervise the mentor relationship through regularly scheduled contact to offer professional advice and support to the mentor. Many of the children in Stafford County live with a single parent or a grandparent who is challenged by time, finances, or circumstances to provide the necessary support and engagement in educational, athletic, and civic activities. With your support, Big Brothers Big Sisters matches these children with mentors who spend time with them each week and help them to navigate the challenges and adversity in their lives. Our mentors reinforce positive behaviors, attitudes, and values. National research has determined that spending time with a big brother or a big sister mentor leads children to improve school attendance, improve grades, and improve behavior. By partnering with our organization and utilizing our proven model of one-to-one mentoring, you are able to create community change without adding additional services within county departments. We welcome the opportunity to help you. In pursuing our goals, we partner with Stafford County schools and teachers to provide this mentoring. The investment the county makes in its at-risk children results in more students who succeed in school and then become contributing citizens. It results in better schools for all other students and teachers. The guidance counselor at Widewater Elementary School, where Mazin is a mentor, appreciates the support of Big Brothers Big Sisters in bringing mentors to the school for students who need additional support to meet the learning standards and have positive behaviors. We are a prevention program that saves the county and its residents money in the long term. We are also an active member of the Community Collaborative for Youth and Families, led by Stafford County's Director of Human Services, Donna Krause. And I want to commend the board and the county administrator for supporting Donna's involvement in this prevention coalition. It is clear that Donna and Stafford County are the regional leaders for Planning District 16 in comprehensive planning for human services. With Donna's leadership of the collaborative, we will improve the mental and social health of our children, which will have a positive economic impact on our entire community. Big Brothers Big Sisters is proud to partner with Stafford County in pursuit of these goals. Thank you very much for your consideration.
Thank you very much. Next is Kathleen Harrigan.
Good evening. My name is Kathleen Harrigan. I'm actually a resident of the city at 1309 Payne Street, but I'm here before you tonight as the immediate past chair of the Board of Directors for Empower House that I've served on for a number of years. I want to thank you first and foremost for your support. For 30 years, the Stafford County Board of Supervisors has chosen to financially support Empower House, and that's been a real benefit to us and to the citizens of the county. In 2017, your support for in the proposed budget for $49,000 is really valuable and necessary, and we build upon the support that you provided in 2016 for our operating funds, as well as for the capital campaign that we ran to open up our new shelter. It's important to recognize that the contribution, while very large from Stafford County, represents 5% of a $1.28 million budget for Empower House, the balance of which is really comprised of some other jurisdictional funding, but it's grants from foundations and other governmental agencies that really is the bulk, and then private contributions made by individuals and corporations from this region. And so, like Janelle mentioned earlier, it's vital for us to have that partnership with our local jurisdictions in order to leverage that money to get grants and foundation funding from individuals as well as others. That value is $457,000 worth of effort and support through the court systems, through support groups for our shelter services and our hotline to citizens of Stafford County alone. That's not the rest of the jurisdictions. This past year, we're three quarters of the way through our fiscal year, we have served more people in housing and shelter this 9 months than we did in all of 2016 from Stafford County. And the citizens that we've served from Stafford County represent the largest number of citizens we are serving across all of the five jurisdictions. 862 domestic violence victims have been served by Empower House during fiscal year 16. It's also important to recognize that that trend continues. 2,300 victims, women and children and men, across the last 3 years from Stafford County alone. It's important to see how this all ties together. It's not just our shelter, which is good and important and very, very vital, but it is the hotline. It is court advocacy. It is having somebody local here answering that phone 24/7, being able to do safety planning and work somebody with somebody to make sure they know what they can do, what services are available. One of the new programs I want to tell you about is the healthcare training that we've done and focused on North Stafford. In the past year alone, we have worked with 50 different healthcare offices, not people, but offices in North Stafford to provide them training on domestic violence and how they can ask. So thank you for partnering with us. Thank you so much for your support. We look forward to working with you and your offices throughout the upcoming years. So thank you.
Thank you. And next is Dennis Fallon.
Good evening, and thanks for having me. My name is Denny Fallon. My wife and I live off of Brook Road at 94 Sentinel Ridge Lane near the entrance to Crow's Nest in the Aquia District. We've been residents of Stafford County since 2007 when Lockheed Martin transferred me down here from upstate New York. This is my third or maybe fourth opportunity to address you speaking on behalf of Empower House, and I promise this year to respect your time. I've been a volunteer supporting them since 2007. I've been there on call, 1-800-CALL-DENNY handyman, since about 2009 or 2010, and I was recently invited to join their board. I accepted that invitation on one condition, that my role as their on-call handyman not change a single bit. I didn't want the fact that I was on the board all of a sudden to interrupt my ability to be immediately available to the staff at Empower House to be able to fix the things that they need to have fixed. I didn't want some protocol to get in the way. They were kind enough to accept that. So I'm able to support Empower House and especially the ladies there at the shelter. Speaking of the shelter, and you just heard some words about it, I'm there approximately 2, sometimes 3 days a week, helping them through the growing pains of learning what it means to live in this new, larger environment that they're in. Hanging things on the wall, stopping small leaks in the bathrooms and in the kitchens, and also coordinating other volunteer efforts from Lockheed Martin employees, Stafford Church groups, and other local volunteer groups. This allows us to get the big jobs done when the folks at Empower House can really prioritize and focus on the things that are important to them. It's funny, the ladies are starting to get to know me around there, and from time to time they'll say, the leg on that table over there is a little wobbly, can you fix it? Or the cabinet door's coming off in that room, can you tighten it up? So I guess that's what I'm there for. It's sad to think that a community like ours needs an organization like Empower House. Having said that, we're really very fortunate to have them. Their focus is all of planning District 16. However, they provided services, you just heard the number, to 862 Stafford residents in fiscal year 16. That included providing shelter, accompaniment to court, support by phone, and also group support sessions. We certainly appreciate the 30 years of financial support that Stafford County has provided to Empower House, including the recent capital funds that helped convert the idea, the dream of a new shelter into reality. Very much appreciated. And thank you for continuing support to support Empower House with the impactful budget that's in place this year. I'm here as a volunteer. I'm here as a Stafford County resident, and I'm here to say thank you for your support to Empower House. It is impactful.
Thank you, Mr. Fallon. And last speaker card is Ms. Callender again, Elaine Callender.
Good evening. Lancaster Street in Falmouth. First, I'd like to make a brief request that you add a historic planner to staff. That will help you more fully utilize Stafford's historic sites for tourism, something that would contribute to the economy here. The second thing I'd like to talk about is the importance of supporting the partner agencies. Not only is it the compassionate thing to do, it is also a fiscally responsible thing to do. If you provide social services to people in need, you give them a helping hand, and you steer them in a positive direction away from a path to the Rappahannock Jail. I have a tragic example to give. It's about a real person who currently is in the Rappahannock Regional Jail. This woman has struggled with mental illness throughout her life. When she lost her family support network, her life fell apart. She no longer had health insurance coverage, and her mental illness was full-blown at that time. She was not able to, on her own, navigate the system to get the care she needed. She got into trouble with law, was ordered to attend regular therapy sessions, which she missed periodically, and she missed court dates because of her inability to manage her own time and the fact she couldn't rely on an alarm clock to get her up in time because she couldn't pay her electric bill. This is just a fraction of a much more involved story, but the point I want to make is we need a strong safety net in our community, plenty of mental health caseworkers, plenty of legal aid workers, public defenders who have time to devote to helping individual clients, fuel assistance, housing for those in need, health care for the uninsured. No ill patient should go without medicine or therapy because of lack of funds for a copay. But keeping the cost of not providing services to people in need, building the problem of people caught up in an uncaring world. We can put money into incarceration, or we can put money into preventing crime by giving people a helping hand. We must do more of the latter. When I hear these agencies ask for level funding, I know they need more than level funding. In fact, this woman I referred to, when she was trying to get help from legal aid, she was told they had already met their quota for the year. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Callender. And that was our last speaker card, but anyone else in the chamber that would like to address us may come forward and do so. Hello.
Okay. Good evening, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. I realize the critical need.
Oh, you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
We know who you are, Ms.
You already know who I am, but yes. My name is Irma Clifton. I live at 100 Carter Street in beautiful downtown and historic Falmouth. I realize the critical need of human services to citizens of Stafford County and the shrinking resources available to provide those services. But I'd like to remind you not to lose sight of the long-term historic and cultural resources that are needed in our county. In addition to the two issues that I bring up to you each time I come up here, closed captioning for the Board of Supervisors and Planning Commission meetings, and funding a historic preservation officer position in the planning office, I'd like to add a plea for funding for Shelton Cottage for the preparation of a presentation and conservation plan with an eye toward renovation to making it a usable structure available to the community for a wide variety of possible uses. I'd like to invite you to investigate a resident curatorship program, which was given enabling legislation in the 2012 General Assembly, which enables localities such as Stafford County to care for their structures that are in the public domain. What that is, it allows the county to work with individuals who have an interest in preserving these structures, either for home or commercial use. The individual bears the expense of doing that. However, they're given a period of time to live in that structure rent-free. So it's a win-win for counties that are having problems with their historic resources. And I was lucky enough to work on a project that got approved while I was on the History Commission in Fairfax County, and I was partially responsible for getting that legislation passed. But there are now five different sites in Fairfax County that have been advertised as being available for people to, it's sort of like an adoption, and you just live there for that period of time. It does not take taxing responsibility away. It does not take utilities. People still have to pay that, but they live there rent-free. And in a community that has housing costs that is as high as Stafford County, this can be a real go-to. It's also available for commercial. There's one site in Maryland that has been converted to a restaurant. So you might want to investigate that.
Thank you, Ms. Thank you. Clifton. Would anyone else like to address us?
Good evening.
Good evening.
I wasn't planning to speak, so I'm a little bit unprepared, but...
No problem, me too.
Here we go. good evening. My name is Marshall Davis, and I live off of Dockstone Road in Stafford, Garrisonville area. I am also the relatively newly appointed grad program manager with Open Hand of Fredericksburg. And I am a lifelong resident of Stafford County, with the exception of a few years when I lived in an area of Northern Virginia. During those few years, I participated in a summer youth worker program. And I can't tell you how beneficial it was to me and my low-income family. So I stand here before you on behalf of Open Hand and the grad program, which Linda so wonderfully convinced me to come back to the nonprofit industry to work for because of this program. I read a story about a participant in the program last year who was a young woman who had been adamant that she wanted to open a clothing store. She wanted to be a store owner. And no matter what her mother or her guidance counselor told her about how much hard work it would be, there was nothing they could do to deter her. So as part of the program last year, they were able to place her in a local retail shop. So she enjoyed the experience, but boy, did she tell us it was difficult. At the end of the program, she was able to say that she now understood why her guidance counselor thought it was a good idea that she take an accounting class. This is really just to illustrate the importance of how this program can give these students a practical work experience, help some of them learn whether or not they really even want to go into the career
career field that they have thought about going into. In addition to the work experience, we do offer those workshops where we talk to them about their experience and, you know, they're able to discuss it. To some of you. But this program has operated on a small scale in the city of Fredericksburg for over 10 years successfully. A couple of years ago, they started expanding into Stafford and Spotsylvania counties. This year, we were formally able to get into the school systems. So we've been getting a lot of referrals between the school systems and partnering with Stafford Junction. I am almost overwhelmed with the number of applicants we've gotten this year. We don't want to turn anybody away. So I just, in closing, I want to note, you all know, give a man a fish, teach a man to fish. If you teach a man to fish and he doesn't have money to buy a fishing pole or access to lakes or ponds, he's really not much better off than he was before. So we're not asking for money to give away fish. We're asking for money to give fishing lessons, to help them buy fishing poles, and to give them access to lakes and ponds. I hope you'll reconsider the opportunity to fund Open Hand. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to address the board on this topic? All right. Then I will close the public hearing section and bring this back to the board. And I want to say before we have a discussion or an entertain a motion, that this particular group of people that came before us tonight represents an amazing, as it was said, a safety net, a social safety net for our residents, and we use our, or most of you at least, and some hopefully, that our social services department turns to whenever we run across a particular need. Things like we heard it, but the United Way, Open Hand of Fredericksburg, Mental Health America, the Fredericksburg Food Bank and Powerhouse, Legal Aid, Quinn Rivers, that helps people with all kinds of things, mortgage payments, disability resources, Big Brothers and Big Sisters. I just think it's an amazing group that does a lot for our community, and I don't thank you enough, at least. And so I just wanted to thank you. I see you year after year. You're passionate about what you do. There's a lot of you come back after year. So thank you.
Mr. Chairman, can I make one comment?
Sure. We're back to the board, and we can talk about it.
So for some of these agencies, Quinn Rivers, I think Open Hand, they are not in the proposed budget to be funded. And I'd like to see if there's members of the board would, I'm going to volunteer myself and then kind of look to Mr. Snellings because he's on social services and see if he'd be interested in working with some of these groups and Mrs. Krause and see if we could find a way to move some money around.
Well, I'd like to, before I commit to that, I'd like to find out why they were left out. I mean, I'm sure there are valid reasons. But I would like to investigate that before I commit to start moving money around.
Well, that's what I want to look at, is why some of these were left off, and meet with Ms. Krause. And
Ms. Chairman, there's actually a meeting scheduled this week with the two of you all to discuss this, and I think we could carry that topic a little further if you'd like to address that concern.
I'm going to come right back to the board.
And I think that would typically come back to the FAB meeting, which would be on the 18th. So if there's anything that comes out of that discussion, we could carry it forward on that agenda.
Mm-hmm. Certainly fine by me. Tonight we are faced with passing a budget, advertising.
Yeah, the vote is on the 18th.
We don't have to make a decision.
Tonight is just to take the public comment, and then the 18th is when you're scheduled to consider adoption.
There's no advertisement.
So a final FAB meeting is scheduled on the 18th as well.
Is that the only thing we want to discuss? I see that. All right, and the last item on our agenda is finance and budget, consider fiscal year 2018, 19, and 20, Virginia Public School Authority debt. Do you want to tell me?
Yes, Mr. Chairman,
our about that one?
Finance and Budget Director will speak to this item briefly.
Wonderful.
Good
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I'm Maria Paracci, financial officer. This time has been advertised for public hearing to authorize a general obligation bonds through the Virginia Public School Authority. These are bonds that would finance infrastructure projects for schools for the next year. The bonds for Moncur have already been appropriated. Those are the other, that's the other large project in the CIP. So this is simply in accordance with the adopted CIP to fund some infrastructure projects. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Anyone have any questions? Ms. Bonke.
Ms. Perot, so I have a question. I understand everything that's stated in the write-up, but then I felt like there was a little bit of a conflict, and I'm sure you can explain this to me. In the first whereas in the resolution, it refers to a number of different projects, which I know we do that when projects aren't as specific, but in this particular one, it looks like it's all for HH Pool, and then let's see if I can go down here. Then there was another project as well, but the way it seemed like it was kind of open-ended, that we threw a lot of other projects in the resolution in the first whereas, and I don't know, I wasn't sure. Comfortable with that.
There are a number of infrastructure projects, and with VPSA bonds, if one comes in a little bit higher or lower than is originally anticipated, there's a flexibility to rearrange those, and the school staff and the school board sometimes will make some minor adjustments. Again, it's all for infrastructure projects that are on the infrastructure list identified in the CIP.
Okay, so even though the write-up says $1.2 million for these specific projects, it all goes into the original big pool with VPSA.
That's correct.
Got it. Thank you.
All right. Any other questions? Okay.
Do we have any information on this North Stafford, the gym floor? In all these redistricting meetings, one of the things that came up is parents are asking, why are we playing for a gym floor and bleachers when we have other needs there? Did the school tell us why they're paying for a gym floor and bleachers before anything else?
I'm not sure if anyone from schools is here this evening. We have not really questioned. They generally do prioritize those smaller infrastructure projects. We could certainly try to get more information on that.
Okay. I don't know if we have time, but that is something that's come up from the North Stafford parents, is they would much rather see the money spent somewhere else, but if that's not really our purview, so...
Well, and there's no action requested tonight. This action will be taken in conjunction with adoption of the CIP in 2 weeks. So okay. We can certainly get you more information on that.
Right. Thanks.
Thank you.
Any more questions? All right, let me open the public hearing up on this item. Would anyone like to address the board on this item, VSPA? Okay. I will close the public hearing and bring it back to the board. One action, if any, is required here.
No action is required,
Mr.
Chairman.
Thank you. And with that, I think we are finished with our meeting. All right. Thank you for coming out. Meeting adjourned.